Welcome to the 28th episode of Teachers Glasses Presents Bollywood Talkies with Outlook. I'm your host, Mitrajit Bhattacharya, and my guest tonight is the winner of 2 national awards, 4 Filmfare awards, and many other Indian and international awards, both as an actor and a director. She also happens to be the first guest who has had a family member already appeared on this show. Let me welcome, without wasting any time, Konkana Sen Sharma to Teachers Glasses Presents Bollywood Talkies with Outlook.
Hi, Mitraji. Thank you so much. Happy to be here. Looking forward to the chat.
We just lost the last of the Renaissance men of Bengal, Soumitra Chatterjee. Your family, particularly your mother, knew him closely, sharing screen space in countless Bengali movies like Basanto Bilap, Chuti Fade, Akash Kushum, etc. since the 70s. How do you see the legacy he leaves behind, both as an actor of global repute and as a Bengali icon?
Yeah, it's been really sad with the passing of Soumitra. I think, you know, what we have all said is that he's really been the last of his kind in many ways.
Right.
My memories of Soumitra, I think, is like from childhood. Because, in fact, I remember when Chhotraji Kre died, I think Doordarshan did a retrospective of his films. And that's when I actually saw my first few Ray films.
Right.
And honestly, he was the first and only Bengali leading man who appealed to me and who had such an international appeal,
right,
and such an international kind of a presence. His choices reflected that, his choices of films and even his outlook in life, you know, the things he kept himself busy with, the issues that he spoke up for, how he liked to pass his time. All of these things point to a certain sensibility, I think, which doesn't exist anymore. It reminds one of, you know, the India that one grew up in. You know, not at all materialistic, kind of a pursuit of the arts, of different kinds of arts, poetry and fine arts and theatre, of course, literature. And it's certain kind of sensibility which is really lacking nowadays, an all-round kind of a personality. My mother and Aparna Soumitra had a certain kind of appeal, which was not as, mainstream as
Soumitra. Not as massy.
But still had a kind of what I would say is how they say a thinking man's hero or a thinking man's couple with a slightly with an intellectual pursuit, a layer of that as well. So there are a lot of people to whom that appealed, you know, and there are very few alternatives for that. It's not like we have a lot of those around. So that makes it all the more rare and special.
And he was quintessential Bengali, like he never moved out and tried to do different things in different places. So my second part of the question was, what's the legacy leaves behind as a Bengali icon?
That's true, but you know, it was a different time and space. The cultural landscape has changed so much since then that I wonder if, even younger artists with that kind of a sensibility can still afford to make those kind of choices and yet thrive. Right. I don't know about that. That remains to be seen, actually. You know, if artists can thrive in that sense, because he had people like, you know, Ray or Minal Shen, etc., others who I don't exactly know, but even in terms of theatre, etc., he had a whole cultural community around him who also subscribed to similar worldview, to a certain worldview, which always helps. I think that is sorely lacking nowadays. And one can't really survive in a vacuum. One has to, inevitably is drawn to like-minded people it's always helpful when one has that kind of support or community around you. And that community, I think, is lacking nowadays.
Not many know that you made your debut as a child artist and that too as a boy in a movie called Indira. But your adult debut happened with Ek Jee Aache Konna in 2001.
That's right.
Were you prepared at that stage to face the camera, or were you still experimenting? Because I think you have quite openly admitted that you were not very sure whether you wanted to take up acting as a profession and a career?
You know, I think over the years, even in my teenage years, I did take part in, you know, some drama competitions in school, or, you know, my grandfather, Chidananda Dashgupta, right, did the Amodini, in which I acted. And, you know, Ritu Panda Ghosh's film or my mother's film, Shruti, etc. I mean, I did little bit odds and ends here and there, but in the sense that, you know, for example, if one had a family business, you know, one might help out.
Yeah.
Or just be involved in a, almost in a community kind of a sense. So it was more in that spirit than really any pursuit of acting or anything like that. I, in fact, was quite clear that I didn't want to be an actor, because many people, when I was young and I started doing little things like this, many people told me that, you know, you're a good actress, you should continue to act. And I actually felt that people are just, you know, being nice to me. These are my family, friends, well-wishers. So they're being nice, and that they're biased, that they don't really know, you know. And I particularly wasn't enamored of acting and didn't feel like consciously taking it up as a serious decision as a career. So I, it's not like I had anything else particularly in mind. Right. I was a bit of a, I think I was a bit of a slacker and, you know, a bit of a dreamer. So I was just going along, you know, kind of doing things that interested me, and mainly literature and arts and things like that. And I was.
But you were studying in St. Stephen's in Delhi.
That's right.
So you went back, you did the movie Ajay Ashay Khanna, and then, you know, kind of.
Well, you know, actually. Back. No, actually what happened is that Ajay Ashay Khanna came to me while I was in my second year of college.
Right.
And shooting took place between my second and third years.
Right.
We get a long 2.5-month break or something at that right. time. So one finished the film at that time, and then I completely forgot about it. I never thought that, you know, this film will release, and how people will, what the reception will be, and what people will think, and how it will affect my life. I didn't give it a second thought. I just did the film. I wasn't dying to do the film at that time. But I read the script, and it was quite a, what we call nowadays, for the lack of a better word, a bold kind of a character. And I was a little uncomfortable, and I used to be like, why is this character behaving like this? I didn't really initially like that character very much, and I wasn't dying to do it. But I remember that my mother said, you know, it's an interesting and an unusual kind of an anti-hero kind of a role, and, you know, you might be appreciated for it, you might want to try it. So I've generally been open-minded, and I thought that let me give it a shot, let me try. It's not like I'm doing anything very much in my summer vacations, and I did act. I was very unhappy during the shooting of it, and then I forgot all about it.
Unhappy or uncomfortable?
Both.
Okay.
I think I was unhappy because I was uncomfortable, because the people okay. were lovely. I mean, the director, he was really lovely. I mean, all the people around, my mother was also involved, you know, she right. did some workshops with me, and I had a lovely, you know, support system, and I was very, very lucky and very privileged to have this kind of support going into my first film. I was already very familiar with film sets. I knew how they operated. There was a great familiarity and comfort.
Right.
On, you know, with being in a studio and all of that. But the things that I had to do, you know, I was a bit of a snob then. I'm still a bit of a snob, and I was, you know, constantly looking down. Why is this like this? Why is this like that? And, you know, not enjoying it very much. The film went on to do very well. I got some state awards at that time, and some recognition, basically, and some interest in my work.
Let me slip in a different question. If you did not pursue acting, what else would you have done?
I think that I would have done my master's in literature.
Okay.
I would have completed my master's. I had started it. I would have completed my master's, and then I think I would have looked for a job in advertising or publishing or something.
Okay.
I was also wondering the same thing. I mean, what do English literature graduates do? And I would have, I knew that I had to work, and I knew I wanted to work, and that's all. I mean, I've always seen my mother working, so I knew that I wanted to be independent and work as well. But it's not like I had any clear ideas about what exactly I was going to do to earn the money.
So the very next year, which is 2002, you did two movies with two best directors the country has produced, which is Titli with Rituparna Ghosh and Mr. and Mrs. Iyer with your mother, Aparna Sen. Talk about your experience of working with these two greats, who also happen to be friends, collaborators and colleagues.
You know, it always makes me think that how lucky and privileged I have been in my journey. Because this doesn't happen to many people.
Sorry. Just between both of them, they have won some 27 national awards, if my research is right.
had I been aware of all of these things at that time, I think I would have been, I don't know, I may have been intimidated. But the fact is that, I mean, I've always had a wonderful relationship with my mother, and she has a habit of treating me as an equal. I automatically have always treated her and others around as equals. You know, that's how kind of we were brought up. Right. And Rituparna Ghosh, Ritu Mama, I used to call him. He used to come over all the time. And those years were idyllic years. He used to come over all the time. My mother and he would chat for hours. They would do adda in the afternoon, at night. We would watch films together. Often they would include me and, you know, discuss their film ideas. And I would come back from school sometimes to find them, you know, chatting. And then I would join them for a bit. So it was a very, very easy, comfortable atmosphere. I was always very happy and comfortable with them. I enjoyed their company very much. So I didn't think too much of them as public personas outside of what I knew. Even way before Titli, I remember he said, now you have to do Titli, otherwise you're going to become too old to play this part. So I said, okay. And I had finished my college at that time. So I was free before I started my master's. And it was really like a family vacation because it was me, my mother, my you know, my stepfather Kolan Rai, who is wonderful, wonderful human being, who you know, we all get along very well, and Ritu Mama and all his associates. It was the opposite actually of Agjay Chakurna, because I was very comfortable. I mean I didn't really feel like work at all, and it finished, I think, in some 18 days.
So that was like that extended home for you, like in the sense you were just meeting people you were comfortable with at home. But at work.
Sometimes they tell me to, you know, say these lines here and there, and I would do it by the by. It was kind of like, you know, on the side almost.
But just one trait, if you remember now, if you look back, because now you are you are a national award winning actor. Now, if you look back, can you get us one trait of Rituparna Ghosh which made him one of the best directors India has ever produced?
Well, I'm sure there are many. A couple of things I can think of offhand is that he is extremely culturally well-versed. He's very well read, and you know, he had watched and read a lot culturally, both in English and in Bengali, which gave him a certain, I think, ease in the and he you know, in the manner that he approached things. I mean, he culturally very rich. So all of those influences kind of, you know, mingled with each other, and they found their place in his works, in his films. I think that is definitely one aspect. The other thing I would say is that he had a certain ease and charm with human beings. You know, where there was a lot of warmth and affection and a certain ease of manner, which not a lot of people have. I can see in myself sometimes, and sometimes in other people, that, you know, sometimes when you want to do something, you know, you're kind of tense about it, and you end up making people around you a little tense as well.
Right.
But I think that he didn't have that. He had a certain, he could make you feel very welcome. He spoke to you kind of very one-on-one. He gave you a lot of respect. When I worked with him, I think I've done 3 films with him.
Right.
Two have released, and the third one hasn't. And he had offered me another one, which I couldn't do at that time. But right from the start, even when I was such a novice and such a young girl, really, he always, like, he asked me, he said, you know, you do the art direction in this film. And I was like, no, Mama, how will I be able to do it? I have no experience. He said, of course you'll be able to do it. But so he had this kind of ease and confidence, you know, in others, and he could recognize, I think, these good qualities in people. He would also tell me, like, even when we did Dosho together, I remember him, and firstly, again, the film finished so fast and so easily that one barely knew one was shooting because one was having so much fun. He knew how to enjoy life. Even during Dosho, I remember that during shoot, he and I sitting down with the script, and he said, you know, I'm saying it in English now because it's in English. I remember him saying that, you know, this is not quite working, this climax is not working, let's edit it, come. Okay. So he and I sat, and we just started cutting out things, and I was like, no, we don't need that. And I was such a young thing,
yeah.
And it speaks volumes, you know, for him that he actually had that kind of confidence, not of course in himself and also me, and to give me that to share that with me, you know. So that's the way he functioned.
And about your mother, when she was on this show before, and we had a little chat about you and Mr. and Mrs. Iyer, so she spoke a lot about your research, which you did in Chennai on the Iyers and Iyengars and stuff like that. And obviously it worked somewhere. And the way the little things which she used to do to train you, speak in Tamil and stuff like that. And that resulted in probably your first national award.
Yeah.
So just talk a bit about that that part, how you prepared for Mrs. Iyer?
I would be happy to, because those are some of my best memories. I remember at that time that the computer used to be in my room, because, you know, we used to have that desktop and CPU and all of that, and the computer used to be in my room, and she'd be sitting and working a lot, and I think this is just when I'm out of college, so I had some free time, and I used to be lazing around and reading and things. That's mainly what I did, I think. And she would keep reading out what she's written. And I mean, I'm used to that. We've been doing that since I was a child, pretty much. Right. I've been hearing her story since I was a child. And right. I used to love listening to that. And she later told me that it was the expressions on my face which made her feel that I should do the role. Because I remember once she said, finally, she said, "Ita tu hi korene."
Right.
I think you should do it. And I was like, don't be silly. You know, don't be mad. Why should I do it? You should take a South Indian person to do it. You should take, you know, and I suggested some names as well, you know, that they should do it. And I think she was not so convinced. And she said, no, you shouldn't do it. And I was like, no, I can't do it. Don't be silly and all of that. And that she's very smart. And I think
she actually said that, you know, I wanted her to go to Chennai because I wanted her to get hooked onto this thing and come back and be ready to do the role. You know?
She told me that, okay, fine, I just need you to do some research for me. So can you go to Madras? I said, okay, that I felt very, you know, like a journalist, I felt excited about.
Yeah.
And I was out of college and I didn't have much to do. And I went and spent a week or 10 days in Madras with my parents' friends, Arundhati, who's Tulima, she was absolutely fantastic. And I had a list of questions, and which she helped me with. And I also made a list of questions. And what is the difference between the Iyers and the Iyengars, which who are Shaivites and Vaishnavites, and what kinds of names they would have. For example, earlier the child's name was not Santanam, I think it was something else, Murugan. But then we realized that Murugan is not an Iyer name. And you know what kind of jewelry they would wear. Like, they don't have a Mangalsutra, they have a Tali, they have a Nalli, which is a wedding ring. And I remember all of this because it was so organic and easy to do, because I was actually interviewing people. I was going to the temples. I was eating that kind of food. I was interviewing those mamis, what they call those ladies in the temple. And I had a wonderful time. I just had a blast. So I came back armed with all this information. And then she said... And by then I was kind of beginning to accept a little bit, okay, let's see, who knows, kind of a thing. And then, and even the gentleman who played my father in the film, he and I and my mother, my parents in the film and I, we would chat a lot, and we had these workshops with Shohak Sen, and, you know, try and get the accent. And I remember that time that I was a little shy. I've always been very shy. And I didn't want to really start, you know, talking in that accent. So my mother would make it a game and say, like, if you're out shopping or just running some errands together in the car, she'd say, come, let's talk like that. And I'm like, no. Then she'd start talking like that. So I'd also start talking. And we kind of get, you know, a lot of practice doing that. And we did a lot of workshops as well.
That's indirectly his method acting. I mean, she was getting you into...
She reeled me in.
Oh, we'll talk about your mother again later.
Yes.
Your recognition... in Hindi movies came with Madhur Bhandarkar's Space 3, where you played a journalist, Madhvi Sharma. How did that come about, your entry into Hindi?
You know, again, it was not planned at all, because actually, even after I finished shooting Mr. and Mrs. Iyer, I went back to Delhi and I was looking for jobs. I would circle those ads in the paper, the... What is it called? Yeah, I would circle
classifieds,
those classifieds, and I would go for interviews as well, you know, thinking that I have to now get a job. And I'd already done one or two other films. Other than Titli and Ajay Chakorna, I did Mr. and Mrs. Iyer, and I did a film called Amu. Or maybe that was a bit later. But basically, Chai Pani, etc. There's another film I did called Chai Pani, etc., which I did at that time. But I thought that, okay, now I've kind of experimented with films and now I should just get a proper job. At that time, I think Mr. Masai had released possibly at that time, and then I got the national award.
Right.
And I remember I was sleeping, and I think it was my stepfather who woke me up at early morning and told me you won the national award, and I didn't even know really what it meant. And I was like, oh, wow, amazing. And I went back to sleep. But when I woke up, the world had changed, because there were journalists outside the front door and photographers outside the front door, and the phones were constantly ringing.
Right.
And I realized that there's a lot of attention, you know, that which is on me now. And because of that, I think Madhur Bhandarkar around that time called me. And I had seen Chandni Bar and I had loved Chandni Bar. And when he called me, I was really excited. And he said, I want you to do my next film. So I was very excited about that. I said, oh, wow, that's great. And then I said, okay. And I just went to Bombay. And we shot that film over many months, like little bits. I would be in hotels and I would come back to Bombay, sometimes in Delhi, because I was still wrapping up my apartment in Delhi, and sometimes in Bombay, sometimes in Kal. So those years were like that. And we just did Page 3 like that without really like thinking about what it would be, or that, oh, now I'm doing a Hindi film, now I must try Hindi films, nothing like that. And I honestly, in my whole life, I've never really thought ahead. I mean, I barely know what I'm doing next weekend, you know, so forget about like down in the future. So even at that time, I was like, okay, let's do an indie film. Let's see what it's like. And then I'll get a job. I don't know what I was thinking, really. I was not thinking very much. And I just did that film. And I enjoyed that experience somewhat. I mean, there were nice people, etc. I didn't really, I couldn't understand how the film was shaping up because we just did bits.
Right.
And that was my first experience of shooting in Bombay. And, you know, having like a vanity van and, you know, like working with a lot of people I didn't know. When I got, so I never saw Page 3, like for myself, from the inside, I'm telling you, I never saw Page 3 as a debut or like now I'm doing Hindi films. I just saw that, oh, okay, this one film has just come. So I remember when I got some awards for it, I think I got some debut award or something like that. When I went up on stage, I remember saying, but you know, this is not my debut. I've done 3-4 films before this also. I didn't know that I would continue to do Hindi films either. I just thought, okay, maybe I'll do a few more, maybe not. That's how it was.
With Omkara Vishal Bhardwaj's Shakespearean adaptation of Othello, you won your second national award for your portrayal of Indu Tyagi, which is Emilia. Just a brilliant performance, which will be etched in our minds forever. How did you prepare for the role? And also, I'll slip in a more broad question. Are you a method actor or are you a spontaneous actor?
Sure. I would like to say first about Omkara that I think by that time I had done quite a few films already. Right. And I had actually come out of a long sickness. And I loved Maqbool like everyone else. Right. So I was really excited about Omkara. But I remember when I went for the reading and went for the shoot initially, I was quite intimidated because I think it was one of my first few films where there were a lot of Bollywood stars. So I was...
It was a large ensemble cast. Like, I mean, it had so many big stars like Ajay Devgan, and it made Langda Tyagi world famous, Seth's career and everything.
Seth, Kareena, was very big at that time. So it was a lot of very mainstream actors, very big stars as well. And I was, I think, a little shy and intimidated by all of that. So I kind of really stayed within myself. Even the first reading, I remember that I was not comfortable and familiar with the language. So that was a great difficulty for me. In fact, they had recorded all the dialogues for all the actors in advance and given us a CD so that we could hear it and become more familiar with the language and the dialect. Right. Because it's not like Hindi, I'm very good at Hindi. And then on top of that, this was some Western UP dialect. So it was really difficult for me. Mitrajit, before every shot, my throat would become parched and I would smoke a cigarette because I was so nervous the whole time.
For the diction and the language, right?
Yeah, for the diction and the language. Because you know, sometimes what happens is if I speak in English or Bengali, even if I start the sentence differently from what is written, I can sing it myself. You know, like I can improvise and change things around, and it makes sense. But I didn't have that luxury, especially in this UP dialect.
Yeah.
So that was very, very nerve-wracking, actually.
Right.
It was very difficult for me. And so I almost had to learn it phonetically because I didn't have the confidence to kind of, you know, improvise or anything like that at all. And it was sync sound.
So did you have a language diction coach for that? Like...
No, we didn't have a coach, but we had our dialogues recorded for us. And then, of course, one just learnt it really well. And then but I was so nervous in the beginning that I remember one day in the early days, I remember Vishal came up to me one day and said, listen, Coco, I want you to concentrate on your acting and forget about the accent. Because he could see that I was getting so nervous. And that really helped. And also, he was so good because I remember that one scene which really makes Hindu's character is the scene where she tells Ajay Devgan, hum dekhlenge Dolly ko. You know, that is when her strength comes out, not when she's laughing and saying "Hasi badi mengi" or whatever. But I remember when he came back and he said you are. He came to my ears and he said, "You're saying this for all women, you know." And he just came and whispered this in my ear, and I understood the gravitas of what I'm saying at that point, and that really helped me. So he's very good with actors like that. Of course, he's very good with everything.
Right.
But that really helped me personally a lot. And, but, you know, I would say that about the other part of your question, which is about the method acting, to be honest, I don't really exactly know what method acting is. I have an idea, but it's not like I ever studied the tech. I'm also quite a flexible actor and I take my cues from the director. So sometimes what happens is I go along, you know, with what the director, how they would like to prep. In the sense that, for example, with Rituparno Ghosh, we never did any rehearsals or any workshops. I mean, we used to have a few chats and I'd read this on my own a couple of times, but we never did any rehearsals. My mother, and of course, it also depends a lot on the role. If the role, if the character that you're playing is close right. to you culturally, socially, economically, then it's not, and not at such a remove, then of course you don't need perhaps to do so much research. But there are times where you're playing a character who is very removed from you, and then of course you need to do more preparation. So that is one element which dictates the preparation. The other element is the director and how they would like to take you through the prep. I personally find now, after so many years, I find that for me, I really, I think that look tests are very important for the character,
right.
what the look test is. Because, you know, like even with Mr. and Mrs. Iyer, moving, what my mother calls it, outside to in. Like whenever I would wear that right. sari, into the hair and, you know, wear the jewelry and take that bag and the baby and whatever, I would immediately feel like Mrs. Iyer. And even though I was, I think, right. 24 or 23 at that point, I was quite young at that point. And so the look test, I think, is important for you to kind of get a sense of where this character is placed and how. I think that rehearsals or readings, you know, reading the script with the director, with the other actors if possible, again and again, you know, and then breaking down the scenes in terms of what the scene means. Am I comfortable with this line? Would I like to change this? Or this is not ringing true to me. How can I make it more? Can we do this later? Can we do this earlier? Just those kind of things are very helpful for me. Also some workshops in terms of improvising. What must have happened just before the scene? Because in a script, you have a scene, right. you may not be seeing what has happened just before, what has happened just after. You know, so improvising and doing those workshops that, oh, this kind of thing. Or you know, like, for example, if it's a character who is used to a lot of manual labor, for example, then you actually have to go through that. So you remember, you have that muscle memory and your body has gone through that, you know. Those kind of things also help. Also that, you know, two more things. One is the intuitive, one is dialogue. So one thing, the other thing that really helps me is knowing the dialogues backwards. Like I remember that something Preeti Bono told me on Titli. He said, I think one day I may have fumbled with the dialogues a little bit. And that's the only ever time he said to me that, you know, it's your job as an actor to know your lines word perfect.
Okay.
And it never happened again that I didn't. And I find that really helps knowing even till today. And especially when I'm acting in Hindi roles that are Hindi speaking. That if I know my dialogues perfectly, it really helps me, of course, in my own confidence. And also that the remembering never gets in the way of the acting. You know, that after this. So, because there are other things you have to remember sometimes. Not the exit or the light or whatever, like the prop. You have to remember many other things also.
Right.
So, so dialogue should be word perfect. And the other thing is, and this is the hardest to describe, is that, you know, most of the time, not just in acting, but in life, I work very intuitively. So I found that I don't even know often what exactly I'm doing for a certain character. You know, it's there in my mind and there are discussions with the director, or I've read the script 3 times. But also I find, and I found this much later in life, that I find that I tweak my life according to the character that I'm playing. So if I'm playing a character, for example, who is very angry or very jealous, then I somehow start behaving like that in my real life a little bit, you know, a little bit. Because I really feel that all these emotions are already inside us, you know. And it's just that I feel like every emotion conceivable is already inside us. And you have to bring out certain things. In different characters, you bring out different things, you know, which are highlighted. So to access, like, I may not be, for example, jealous in the same way that my character is jealous, but I have known jealousy, you know. Even if it's dormant less in scale or whatever. Or whatever, any other emotion, you know, like...
You just have to bring it out from your personal experiences as much as you can. I hope you give warning to people around you so that they know...
I don't even give the warning to myself. I don't even know when I'm doing it. And, you know, it's just very subtle, slight tweaks, honestly. It's just a little tweak. Like, I'll tweak my circumstances in life. Like, if a situation may not have normally gotten me angry, I'll purposely kind of, you know, do extra so that I can use it for my...
Well, I think it's quite a
dangerous thing to do, actually. Of course, it's fun.
Okay. In 2009, you came up with 2 beautiful performances in movies made by directors with similar sensibilities. Wake Up Sid by Ayan Mukherjee and Luck by Chance by Zoya Akhtar. Both my favorites. Talk about these movies a bit and your experiences in being in them.
I did Zoya's film first and then Ayan's. Firstly, though, I love debut directors. I love doing first films because they are so special. Usually, if a director is dying to make his or her first film...
It's like their lifelong work. I mean, adult work, which they must have worked on it for 4 years and then probably the movie has gone on the floor. So, just that much of passion and work which has gone in the first
film. Yes, it's been with them for some time. There has been thought behind it, you know, and proper prep, etc. And so that... I love working with debut directors like that. And particularly these two who are so super talented, and I have so much respect and admiration for them. So I, of course, I was aware of Zoya's script because I remember at that time reading that a lot of actresses had rejected the script and it was not getting made. And I was very curious about what Zoya's going to make. And anyway, I there was an interest, you know. And so then when the project came to me, there was no question, you know. And Zoya's a very charismatic kind of a person. She has a very strong personality and... you know, she's very interesting, you know, outside of her films as well. So I was very pleased and happy to work with her. Right. And there was so much thought and her script was so beautiful, so beautifully written. And I loved the script. And I loved the film also, but I think the script had even more, more love for the script. Working with Zoya, I was, you know, now I feel I know her much more. At that time, I was younger. Again, I was very shy, easily intimidated, keeping to myself. I've been like that, you know, most of my career, just like quietly on my own doing my thing, like not really so actively participating.
You just keep winning some awards in between and again go into your shy zone, huh? Just a few national awards, few filmfare awards.
I was very lucky with those awards, and I think that it became acceptable to give me awards. I think, you know, when you start getting awards, other people feel, oh, this is the person you can give awards. There are so many good actors who don't get awards. And then working with Ayan also was lovely because, again, he had so much zeal, you know. Like, he in fact, I remember him giving me a playlist of music that my character would listen to, you know, things like that, like watching films with me, you know, so I could see that so much thought and effort had gone behind those characters, you know, for both these films. And both were unusual characters. They're not usually characters you see in Hindi films. So they were both like slightly out of the ordinary.
And a line on Ranveer, just a line on Ranveer.
It was wonderful to work with Ranveer. At that time, he was not a big star. He just had that film. And, you know, he was so just pleasant and not at all diva-esque, which I really appreciate. I can't bear it when people draw attention to themselves. And also really sound in terms of technical expertise. Because he'd studied filmmaking. So I remember this one day where there was some confusion about left or right or axis or something, which I'm terrible at still. I mean, I have a vague instinct for it, but it's not like if you ask me, I can like be like, oh yeah, this. And I remember like Anil Mehta, who's such a senior cinematographer, and Ayan in the first, they were discussing and they were a little confused and they asked Ranveer, and Ranveer immediately said, it's this. I was very impressed. I was like, wow, he knows all of this also so well.
A small question and a small answer, because we will keep coming back to your mother's different facets of your relationship with her. So Goynar Baksho, Iti Mridnalini, these are all movies you were doing with your mother. Now, how is the working relationship with her? Professional, comfortable, easy or difficult? So just what's the working relationship with Aparna Sen?
It is professional, comfortable and easy. I wouldn't say it's difficult. I don't know if she'd agree. Because maybe she finds me difficult, I don't know sometimes. But the relationship that we had was always, you know, and the relationship we have even in normal life, you know, there is a certain formality. There is a certain respect, mutual, you know, which is what is extraordinary and astounding because she's so much older and she's my mother. She didn't have it for me. But because she has shown that to me, it has been instilled in me.
Right.
Show it to other people.
Right. In the recent past, you have acted in two thought-provoking movies that show mirror to our society. Lipstick Under My Burkha and Dolly Kitty or Wo Chamakte Sitare, both directed by Alankrita Srivastav. Is it a conscious shift on your part to be to do movies with strong social messages?
No. I think that I've done quite a few of these kind of films, you know. Like, it's not just these two. I've been lucky enough to do these two films with Alankrita, but I have done other films like this, whether it's 15 Park Avenue or Doshore. Or, you know, there are other films also which have had some kind of a, what people call a strong social message. I don't really view films like that. Obviously, I only, you know, it's not like I have my pick of all the films that I made that year. It's not like I get to be like, oh, I'll be in this, this and this. So it's not like that. Out of what is offered to me, obviously, I try to take up a project that has the most appeal for me. Usually there are a few factors, you know, like for example, can I vibe well with the director? Does the director have something to say that he or she is convinced of saying?
Right.
Or have they enough passion or thought that they put enough into it? Sometimes it's a co-actor who I want to work with, you know, or sometimes it's the script which has really spoken to me or the role which has, you know, so interesting, or, you know, I love taking up roles where, you know, which are not static or stagnant, or characters which go through a period of transition or some change, right, things like that. So it's a mix of different kinds of things, you know, which makes me take up a project. I'm thrilled to have come across Alankrita, and I'm thrilled that she's taken me for these two films.
Most satisfying and the toughest role till date? Just one word answer.
15 Park Avenue.
Okay, now let's talk about your feature film directorial debut in Death in the Ganj, a critically acclaimed film that won, again, many, many awards, which is pretty much your thing. Are you comfortable being a director? And how tough was it to shoot an ensemble cast in such a remote location? How tough was the production?
It's very tough. It was very tough. You know, luckily, I didn't expect it to be otherwise. I expected it to be tough. I think that's been my learning, because I've been with scenes, my mother work on so many independent projects, which have been, you know, often tough to put together or execute. Right. So I knew from the start that there would be problems every day. I think I became the best version of myself that I have been till now. Okay. Because I became so focused and so zen, where like troubles would not really upset me. I'd be like, oh, okay. I mean, they would upset me maybe, but it would not be like I would fall apart.
I've heard your script was very detailed in terms of graphics, in terms of how the set would look, and, you know, is that...
It was very detailed. Like, there are shots which are described. Like, just from the top of my head, I can remember the... For example, when Shutu and Mimi have their lovemaking scene on the paper under the chair, those are all written into the script. So there are many things like that which are written into the script as well. And then, of course, there's a wonderful collaboration I had with Shisho, who's done such a fantastic job as a cinematographer. But so it was very tough. Mainly, I think it was tough because we had limited resources in terms of being an independent film. The budgets were low. We didn't have like big stars. We, according to me, we had fantastic actors, but we didn't have big stars, so we didn't get.
And so many of them. I mean, so many of them who are such known actors. Yeah. I mean, so many.
Yeah.
And that also, you shot where? You shot.
We shot in McCluskey Ganj in 30 days.
Yeah.
Which is phenomenal, because I mean, at one point we were going so fast that there was no luxury to kind of. Let's improvise. Let's see if it works like this. There was no chance that it was just like, this is the day. This is my shots. I have to take it. Right. And, you know, just like hustling a lot and just like finding a way to kind of just finding a way to make it work. Yeah. I'm also shooting in McCluskey Ganj, which McCluskey Ganj is so small and so remote that I couldn't even house the crew or the cars. Right. So we actually had to live in Ranchi, which is an hour and a half away. So every day we were in the car.
So 3 hours would go just to...
travel. And because it's winter, your daylight hours are short anyway. I mean, of course, we shot at night as well. So it was very difficult. I wouldn't say, like, while I was in it, that I was enjoying myself so much. Like, that was, it's not, it's kind of like motherhood. It's not like you're enjoying, like, the stress of the baby crying and falling sick. You know, you're not enjoying it. But looking back on it, it was a very meaningful experience.
So I will give you, let's make it fun. I will give you 5 words or phrases. Just comment a line on them. CBFC.
Censor board certification, whatever. Unnecessary. Unnecessary, irrelevant.
Okay. Critics.
Whatever. I think that's like an occupational necessity.
Gender pay inequality.
Unacceptable. It is unacceptable.
Star culture in Hindi movies.
Star culture, I think, is detrimental. I think it's detrimental to artistic, to like trying to experiment within the art form. And it is detrimental to artistic endeavor. Not because of the stars themselves, but the system, the way other people function, the way the system functions around it. Nothing against
challenging the star culture with OTT content.
You know, what's happening is that the OTT content is going to change to accommodate the star culture. Right. That's what's happening. So that is unfortunate. Because already now we have censorship in OTT, which is so unnecessary. I mean, adults can just decide for themselves what they want to watch. I mean, if we can vote for who we want as in our governments, we should be able to choose what kind of films we want, you know? So there should not be such a thing.
Talk about your relationship with Harun. How are you as a mother? Chilled out or paranoid? Or what kind of a mother are you?
You know, I think I'm chilled out. But I think that my mom would think that I'm paranoid. My co-parent and ex-husband would think I'm too chilled out. And my mother would think I'm paranoid. I like to think that I'm a happy balance in between. I don't think I'm too paranoid at all. I'm not a helicopter parent at all. But I'm involved very much. I actually, I have to say, just enjoy him more and more as he's growing up. Because his mind, I'm getting to know his mind, his imagination. his personality. I mean, I have to say that I didn't really enjoy like him as a baby so much because, I mean, I was dealing with a lot with like how my life has changed and like what it means to take care of somebody who's so small and, you know, how that is so stressful, etc. But since the time that he turned like 2, 3, 4 onwards and now too, it's a delight. Touch
reading books or watching movies, which one more?
Reading books. Though I have to say that nowadays I do it lesser than I would like.
What's the last book you have read?
I think I read Trevor Noah's memoir. I forget the name of it. That's the one that I just read. Reading 2, 3 books together, fiction, non-fiction, etc. Right now I'm reading the new Elena Ferrante novel.
What's the last movie or series you have watched and liked?
I don't watch things exactly on time because usually I don't get
it. No, it doesn't matter. It can be old. What but have you watched last?
I really enjoyed watching The Jinx. The Jinx and Fargo.
Favorite actor, director from anywhere in the world?
My favorite actor, I would say, is Tilda Swinton. She's just a great alternative to... She's an unusual person. There's nobody else like her. She's very original, both in the way she looks, her choice of films, the kind of roles she does, the things she speaks, the way she lives her life. And Tilda Swinton, I would say.
Director?
Wes Anderson. I don't have a favorite director because it's not like I like many films of one director. I think most directors have like 2, 3 films which are good.
Okay, what's coming up next?
I have written a short film which is slightly futuristic, which I would like to make, but I have to look for funding. It's just taken a backseat because of COVID. I've also acted in an Amazon show for Nikhil Advani. And and I'm reading other scripts and trying to develop my own thing.
Before I let you go, please tell us, what does your lyrical name Konkona mean and the reason of using two surnames?
Well, my name Konkona is the name of a river. You can find it in Tagore songs, Konkona Nodi Dhare, something, something. Right. So that is there. As a child, I didn't like my name very much. I found it very clunky and there were no other Konkonas that I knew of. But I have grown to love my name very much. I really enjoy my name now, Konkona. And I took two surnames because my mother is Sen and my father is Sharma. And when I was about 6, they asked me, would you like to be Konkona Sen or would you like to be Konkona Sharma? And which tells you everything about my upbringing. Those are the kind of parents. And I just thought that if I say one, then the other will feel bad. So I said, let's just do both.
And when did Coco happen?
Coco happened on the sets of a film called Sati. Coco was, the name was given to me by Shabana Azmi, who acted in that film. And it just became my name.
Thank you, Coco, for talking to me on Teachers Glasses Presents Bollywood Talkies with Outlook. Stay safe and see you soon.
Thank you so much, Mitrajit. It was a pleasure. Luckily, I didn't expect it to be otherwise. I expected it to be tough. I think that's been my learning because I've been with, seen my mother work on so many independent projects which have been, you know, often tough to put together or execute. Right. So I knew from the start that there would be problems every day. I think I became the best version of myself that I have been till now. Because I became so focused and so zen, where like troubles would not really upset me. I'd be like, oh, okay. I mean, they would upset me maybe, but it would not be like I would fall apart.
I've heard your script was very detailed in terms of graphics, in terms of how the set would look and, you know, is that...
It was very detailed. Like, there are shots which are described. Like, just from the top of my head, I can remember the... For example, when Shutu and Mimi have their lovemaking scene on the paper under the chair, those are all written into the script.